So now I'm supposed to introduce James. I feel uniquely qualified to introduce James. He's beyond being my co-founder at Percolate, he also sometimes refers to me as his other half, which I'm not sure how Kate feels about that, but I think it's okay. So I think most of you know James or have met James, so I won't go too far into it except to introduce him by saying I think he's probably the person I know who's most excited about the future. He is just totally stoked about everything that's gonna happen. But it's not sort of, it's not just pure sort of kind of unbridled. He brings a real analytical framework to thinking about what that future is going to hold, what that change is going to mean. And that's really what he's going to introduce today in the sort of introduction to what we mean by transition. So I'll introduce James.
All right. Thank you, Noah. Hello, everyone. Hello, transition. I am stoked, just naturally, but I'm also stoked because I think there's a lot of things that are happening that are really, really interesting. And I thought the best way to tell the story of transition and why we wanted to build this conference was to actually tell the story of Percolate and why we started Percolate. Percolate was started in January 2011, almost exactly 3.5 years ago. And towards late 2010, Noah and I got together, and we started to think about things. We started to theorize what we were seeing in the marketing world, what we were seeing from our clients, and where we thought the world was going, right? We had sort of our own little transition moment. And at this time, in like 2010, from a technology perspective and a digital perspective, we were really in the web phase of digital. This was a world where most of us who worked in marketing in 2010 worked in things like search, worked on things like microsites and banner ads and just different email marketing campaigns, right? This was primarily what digital was. And it was a revolution, right? The web had built this new way to connect with customers that we had never seen before, and this was incredibly exciting, right? And I think for all of us that worked in the industry at the time, it was a really exciting time then. But what Noah and I were betting was that social was going to change marketing forever, right? I think we were very optimistic about what we saw from social, right? And we really said, we need to put a flag in the sand, and we need to say that communication, because of the effects of social, we're gonna totally change marketing. And basically, if I were to sort of establish our thesis at the time, it was that we were moving from campaign-based communication, right? So as marketers, we were moving from planning and sort of long cycles and windows and building beautiful assets, sort of what we've always called stock content. We're moving from this world of campaigns to this world of sustained communication, right? Noah likes to say that this is the question he was asked most often in 2010 by his customers, right? What should I tweet about, right? And this is sort of what seems like a very silly question, but it's actually sort of a very big tectonic shift, right? You're moving from being able to plan everything out in a nice, beautiful world to actually a sustained world that never stops, right? And so what we believed was technology was going to get in the way, right? Technology was actually going to be something that could actually help this happen, right? And so we had sort of our 0-1 moment or inventor's moment in thinking about how are we going to build technology to deal with this process. The unfortunate thing about social in 2010 was it wasn't that big, right? And there was a lot of people out there that just didn't believe in anything we were doing, right? The argument on Facebook was it was the next MySpace. It was insane. Like, people were jumping out of windows because it was worth $11 billion, right? We thought the world had come to an end. How could possibly a company like Facebook be worth $11 billion? You know, Twitter was a joke, right? I mean, it was out there, but no one actually thought it was real. It didn't have a business model in 2010, no revenue at the time. LinkedIn was a professional network where you went there when you wanted to change your job status, right? You didn't think about it as any sort of always-on stream, right? There was no Pinterest when we were building our company, when we started the company. There was no Instagram. There was no Snapchat. WhatsApp was just getting started, right? But clearly, and I use this slide because I used to explain WhatsApp, trying to show like why WhatsApp's important, and then Facebook bought it for $19 billion, and I had to stop explaining WhatsApp. But like, you could see, of course, like this wasn't around when we started our company. This idea of unbundling of communication, all these different ways that we were communicating using the internet. Google was squarely a search company. Sort of mission was to organize the world's information, right? And there was no global social platforms. So even though Facebook was worth $11 billion, most of its audience was rooted actually in the US or in the Americas, right? Basically, the largest social platform at the time was in the company, and it was in the country in which it was founded, right? So there wasn't any sort of global proliferation. So what happened, right? Because this is not the world we live in anymore. I'm sort of leading you pretty easily here, that things have changed pretty substantially in 3.5 years, right? And what was the big change? And this is a very, very obvious answer, right? Was we were basically led into the second biggest technology revolution really in the last 4 years, and that's mobile, right? Mobile, as for marketers, changed everything. It really messed with us in big ways, right? It took away Flash, it took away banners, it took away microsites, it took away so many things that we held precious during the web phase of digital, but it also did two other things. It made the concept of communication much simpler, and it also made it much bigger. It made it simpler, right? It made it simpler to actually think about swiping and sharing instantly. And basically, social was able to ride the back of mobile better than any other force, right? If you think about the growth and really the platforms that took off with mobile. And mobile is just starting to sort of rear its head, right? This is a chart showing you the two largest operating systems in mobile, Android and iOS. And the growth shows no signs of slowing down, right? We just came out of the two big developer conferences from Google and Apple. The growth is something that we think will continue to increase. Android has passed 1 billion users on its platform, the fastest technology to ever be adopted by 1 billion people. And of course, iOS is well on its way. And this is going to have, of course, very interesting effects on how we think about the market and how we think about opportunities as we start to use technology at this sort of scale. So let's use social as a lens to understand how mobile is really changing things, right? So for the folks that really liked Facebook back in 2010 and voted on it, they did really well, right? Facebook is one of the largest media companies in the world now. And I don't think there's any question that it's not the next MySpace, right? It's a tremendous powerhouse in the world. Twitter has gone public since the time when Noah and I started the company and is worth quite a bit of money. LinkedIn is very much catering towards a content model and a streams model, and is also a publicly traded company. You have got up-and-coming platforms like Snapchat and Pinterest with sort of massive private market valuations. And so we should stop there and just start to think about what's next, right? So, you know, there's the common sort of concern now, like, are all these companies really worth all this money? This is kind of crazy. These companies are worth as much as the media companies that we've traditionally worked with. You know, what's happening? And how can we think about the future, right? That's what I want to spend the rest of the presentation and, of course, the rest of the day really focused on talking about, right? How do we think about what could be coming next? And in order to do that, of course, this is the theme of the day, right? We believe we're in this massive transition. And it's an interesting word that we really sort of latched onto because it comes with a really interesting quote from the chairman and founder and the former CEO of Intel, right, who sort of famously said, market share is gained and lost at times of transition, right? We're not just excited about the future, we're also thinking about how do we take advantage of this. And of course, I'm not up here fear-mongering, but there's the other side of it, right? Which is the lost side of the transition, which is what we've seen happen, right? You know, there's gonna be winners and there's going to be losers, and we need to start to think about how that's going to play out. And, you know, this is the only sort of fear slide I have, and I hope not to show too many of these. I don't think it needs to necessarily be always told, because I think it's semi-obvious. But this is a cohort analysis of the Fortune 500 going back since 1955. And what you can see is in the red line is 1995. Over time, what happens is companies are staying on the Fortune 500 for less time, right? This classic sort of disruption. And what you're seeing is an acceleration, right? We had technology in the 50s and 60s and 70s. But it's the technology of the modern day that's really causing disruption, right? It's creating valuations like we've never seen before, but it's also destroying the very underpinnings of how we thought about large-scale institutions that we used to just think would always stay around, or we used to think would be able to pivot into their next business model, right? That's not happening. The data reflects that, and that's really interesting. And so from a transition perspective, these are the three sort of topics that we think are really happening in big ways that we've got to think a lot about, right? We're moving to a global world, we're moving to a mobile world, and we're moving to a world that's powered by software. So let's start with global, right? What do we mean by global? Well, I showed you that slide from 2009. And I'm just using social as a proxy. This is by no means only social taking advantage of sort of the global world. This is what Facebook's domination in 2009 looked like, again, mostly in the Americas. And what you could see is over time, it's just spread across the world. It's done this because it's rode the vehicle of mobile, right? Everyone has a computer in their pocket, or a large portion of people have a computer in their pocket. And guess what? They can all download Facebook, and they love it, right? People love to do those sorts of things. And that's why we've seen the great proliferation, right? Again, not just Facebook, but so much of social. And this is happening across a lot of different industries. And then the other just really exciting thing, this is where I start to get more stoked, is when you start to look at the data, right? And so this year, 2014, we are celebrating the 25th anniversary of the World Wide Web, right? Tim Berners-Lee at CERN in 1989 created the modern day World Wide Web, allowing all of us as people to connect, right? And over the last 25 years, at some point this year, we're still at 2.9 something, at some point this year, we're going to cross 3 billion internet users, right? That's a fantastic thing, right? There's really nothing in the world that 3 billion people use other than the internet. But what is projected based on mobile penetration, based on smartphone prices becoming or being reduced, and based on the ability, of course, to put networks around the world, is a lot of people are actually forecasting that by 2019, there'll be 6 billion people on the internet, right? You're talking about a doubling of people on the internet in only 5 years, right? And that is fascinating, right? And this is a great quote from Tim Bray, right? And basically, to summarize it, what he's trying to tell you is our understanding of what happens when we put people on networks is just dimly understood, right? We just don't know. You couldn't have predicted the internet when Tim Berners-Lee showed it to you. You couldn't have understood what it would do. It just had to play out, right? And so it's fascinating to think about the potential of twice as many people being on the internet in just 5 years. As well, we're living through another amazing time as people, right? And that's the idea of a global middle class. This is not the American middle class. This is not the European middle class that we've all come to know. But this is what the World Bank qualifies as people making $10 to $100 a day, right? That number right now is at about 1.8 billion. And what is forecasted is that by 2029, that number is going to be at 5 billion, right? So you're going to have well over 2x the amount of people in the global middle class, right? And that's in 15 years. So I gave you sort of two frames there from a global perspective. One is 5 years, internet penetration, and the other one is global middle class penetration, which will happen, again, all in our lifetime, and pretty fascinating. And as Hal Varian, the chief scientist at Google, says, there's just a really good chance that the smartest person in the world is behind a plow right now in India or China. And what happens when they have access to the internet? What happens when they have available resources that allow them to do other things than plow a field, right? Probably fantastic stuff, right? And that's going to happen in the very near future. So that's global, right? And we're living through that global part of the world. Now moving on to mobile, right? What's happening in mobile, really? What are we seeing in mobile? Well, first, from a marketer's perspective, right, mobile is very different, right? We like to say, I actually have no statistical evidence of this, but you know, you could fight me on it if you want. I believe that pull to refresh is the most used gesture in the world, this idea of what we do on our phone, right, where we pull to refresh it to see something new, right? This is a very different way of thinking, right? I like to say this is sort of like modern day time, right? We used to wear watches to be able to tell each other what time it was, like it was a coordination thing. Now we pull to refresh our screen, which is a very interesting behavior, right? Like you pull to refresh your screen, you have absolutely no idea what's coming next, but you like to do it. It gives you context. It gives you a sense of like who you are and what's around you, right? And that's a really interesting thing. So how do we think about this as marketers, right? Working in a stream world, in an entirely different world. How do we think about delivering messages in a world where I'm constantly pulling to refresh my screen? And then as well, just the data, from a data perspective, oftentimes, we've called mobile the second screen, sort of the complement to TV. And that's fine, but just I call it the first screen if you really start to look at time spent. And this is not an American phenomenon. Again, this is around the world. Time spent around the world has easily eclipsed television at this point in almost every major city and every major country in the world, right? And this will only continue, we believe, right? We believe people are, you know, having more devices and it's proliferating more and more. And then finally, mobile is just creating a much bigger industry. So this is the latest data from eMarketer going from 2012 to the forecast of 2018. And I know as an industry, we often get pretty bummed out sometimes. We talk about, you know, the loss of advertising revenue. It's simply not true. If you look at the data from eMarketer, you're talking about going from almost $500 billion as an industry, which, by the way, is a massive industry, right? $500 billion a year is what the global annual advertising budget is, or revenue is. And we're moving to almost 700, about $680 billion by 2018, right? That's a 35% increase, right? It's very hard to see industries of this size see that type of growth, right? So this is really, really interesting. Technology has had a massive effect on how we think about the ad industry, how we think about being marketers. And then finally, to software, right? How do we think about software? This is more what Noah was talking about, sort of the invention moment, right? What are we seeing from software? Well, there's a very famous venture capitalist and also the inventor of the first sort of commercial web browser, which was called Netscape, the company, Mark Andreessen. And he had a quote from 2011 in a Wall Street Journal op-ed where he said, software is eating the world. And this was taken, I think, by a lot of people and by the industry at large as a very negative thing, right? That software was, you know, the robots were coming for our jobs, that software was coming to displace us all. And I don't think he meant that, and I don't believe that either. I think what he was trying to say is software is going to automate any of the processes that it should, right? That leaves humans to do things that humans are great at, which is be creative and be interesting and analyze things and be able to come to our own conclusions, right? And one way to look at this, a way that I really like to look at this, is to think about the companies that you now look at, that you now work on as marketers. So if you take what I would call software media companies, sort of a lot of those social mobile companies I was talking about before, and you were to stack up their present day market caps, that would be LinkedIn and Twitter and Facebook and Google, and you put those up against traditional media companies, CBS, Viacom, Disney, Comcast, what you see is the opportunity is just bigger, right? It's not that CBS and Viacom, all these guys are going away. I don't believe that. I believe what we're starting to see is the opportunity that software can have on an industry and really where we plan to go, right? This is very directional, and this is the market, right? The market has sort of voted that they think this is where the value in the future is. So these are the questions that I think we need to answer as marketers coming out of this transition, right? One question to have is what happens when the whole world wants and can actually afford your product, right? And again, I'm not talking about jet turbines here, but I am talking about deodorant, I am talking about soap, I am talking about, you know, just different antibiotics, right? What happens when a world has the discretionary income to actually think, you know what, I want that product in my life, right? That's a question that we have to answer at a much larger scale in the very near future. And then on top of that, of course, is what happens when you actually have the means to communicate with them, right? What happens when you actually do have that connection? Before, you just couldn't communicate with them, right? I mean, you would have to buy every sort of real estate space in the world to try to communicate with these people. Now with mobile, the potential to actually communicate and connect with them is very real. And then on the other side of the questions is who is this new marketer, right? Like this is, you know, this is not going to recycle in another time. This is not for the young kids. This is not for the digital natives, right? This is happening like now. And so how do we think about now in this world? And what does a marketer have to think like? Well, the first part is they have to move from thinking about reaching millions of people to billions of people, right? The global side of it. They have to move from campaign-based communication, sort of the early theory of Percolate, right? From a stock world to a stock and flow world. And I say this by also saying, like, the campaign doesn't go away. Planning is critical to everything we do. But how do you juxtapose and balance planning versus the need for an always-on strategy of marketing? And then finally, as a marketer, and again, this really hits on what Noah, I think, was articulating really well, is we have to move as an industry from like thinking about buying media to building systems, right? We have to have our invention moment. The scale is there now. How do we start thinking about having our invention moment and thinking in systems and in technology? So finally, to conclude, this is going to happen while we're in charge, right? You, me, and really everyone in this room, right? I don't think any of you are planning on retiring in the next 5 years or the next 15. Maybe you are. God bless you. That's awesome. But this is going to happen like while we're all actually here, right? So this is what I'm so excited about with transition, right? Like we live in these amazing times where we can talk about these things and actually also know that because of technology, there's a very good chance that they're going to come true. And again, that's where I do start to get incredibly stoked and excited for what is to come, both out in the years ahead, but also in today and the type of speakers that we've been able to put together for you today. So with that, I want to say thank you for your time.